Okay, so hello everyone, and today I have posted the schedule for the meet in the chat. So basically, I'll start by first going through the simple sectory, which has point update and range query, which is the sectory that we study since the beginning. So just to reinforce our fundamentals and make sure that we really understand it properly, so I'll just write it out in code and solve this problem. So what it says here is that you are given n values and you have to entertain two types of queries, either it is a point update or a range query. So let us first write out our sectory. So here I am just defining it as a struct. So generally I like to keep everything in a struct so that it's easier to manage additions or deletions of data. So as you later figure out, when you have more complicated bits of information to handle, it is beneficial to keep everything in a struct. So I just write out the two different update functions. So here I have the update function and here I have the query. So it is important to understand what these variables are. So I'll just write. So there are two variables here, index and then the value to add, that's there. And then these are three variables that are used to keep track of where I am in the tree. So TI is tree index, TL and TR are the tree ranges. So I just drawn a sectory so that it makes it easy to explain. So if I number these nodes as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, of course this is not the correct numbering. Like when you actually compute this numbering, this won't be 8 and 9, but anyway, actually let's just write the correct numbering. So this is 12 and this is 13. So the pattern is always double and double plus 1. So yeah, so the orange thing is tree index and the blue thing is tree range. Right, so this is the general convention that we follow, that whenever we have a node, let's say here it is 3, so then we split into two parts, 6 and 7, so 3 into 2 and 3 into 2 plus 1, and the range also splits in half. So when it's 1 to 2, it splits in 1 and 2, but like here it's 3 to 5, so it splits into 3 and 4 and 5, so it's almost equal, so because the interval is odd length, so it splits like this. So yeah, so when I write TI, this is the orange thing, tree index, and TL to TR is the tree range. Again, the standard stuff that we have been doing. So now we'd say that if IDX is less than TL or IDX is greater than TR, then return. So this is the case when the index is outside the range of the tree. Otherwise, if the tree node is a leaf node, then we just directly update the value in the tree and return. Otherwise, we first define a mid, which I generally keep it like this. Again, you will find different, slightly different implementations. So some will write mid as something else, but as long as it's consistent, it will get the job done. So yeah, and then I need to merge the tree. So again, I'm just leaving out the blanks and I'll fill them later, but this is to get the general intuition of what is going on. So as you can see, the standard recursive point update sectory. And here I have to query. So I have to query from L to R and I'll just maintain the three things here. Again, some people like to keep these as default variables, but I just like to keep it like this. So that's there. So now this is something that people often get wrong. So in this case, what you need to check is that if always the first check should be if the query is outside. So if the query is outside, that is given by if tree node is less than L or this. So if you like stare at this for a moment, you will figure out why this is correct. So again, L to R is the query range. And as I just explained through the diagram, the orange thing is the tree index and the blue things are the tree ranges. So that is TL to TR and the orange thing is TI. So I'm just prefixing with T so that it makes it clear that this is related to the seg tree and nothing else. This is only relevant to seg tree. So then I have to now do the query. So then the next point is that if my tree happens to be entirely inside the, then this, I'll return something. I don't know what, but I'll return something. Then again, now I have the standard split procedure. So you have L, R. So LC is left child and RC is right child. And you do this and you do this, and then you just return A1 plus A2. So again, I'm coding the most basic segmentary, like as most people do it. And now I just want to define the tree. So I generally like to define two variables. So first is the const txpr int n, which I generally keep as whatever the range is. So in this case, I've not written anything. Let's keep it 25 plus 1. Plus 1 is just for safety. Who knows what can happen. So then I'm saying tree data, tree n. So wait, I put this here. So I'll say vector tree data and this name it tree, and then this I'll just resize it to 4 into n. So we keep it 4 into n for recursive, and I'm not going to do iterative here because it's way more complicated. So for recursive we'll keep it 4n. So here I'll just define tree data as ll. So right now I'm just defining it as ll, later we'll scale it up. So now everything can be filled. So tree of ti is plus is equal to add, and here similarly you have tree ti is equal to tree lc ti plus tree rc ti, and then the same thing here. So here you have to return even plus a2 and here tree ti. All right, so yeah, the thing compiles, and I'm not writing the query processing part here right now. I just want you guys to focus on this and like digest it and make sure that this is clear. So this is the general intuition. And now again, all this should be familiar and you should have solved a couple of problems on this, fairly intuitive. So now there are a couple of problems here that I want to bring to your attention. And the first is that we are not really sure where our things are going. So here you have a plus sign. Okay, so before moving ahead, I just want to ask, like, is there any notational problem? Like, is there any part in my code which feels different to you, which you don't understand? Like, I have used a lot of variables. I was explaining them on the way. But if you lost synchronization, just let me know. I'll just check the chat. Okay, so no doubts yet. Okay, so I'll go ahead then. So yeah, there is these notations, and then now we want to jump into the lazy part. So the when we jump into the lazy part, I want you to focus on the word lazy and understand why we have called it lazy. Let's think about it for a moment, and then I'll dive into the actual thing. So why is it known as lazy is something we need to ponder on. So when we ponder upon it for a moment, we realize that there is a big difference in this function and this function that we need to do. So here it is range query, and here it is also range query, same thing, no problem in that. But here you have range update. So let us see what would happen if we don't do a lazy sec tree. If we do a normal sec tree, how would we be doing this range update? So the way we would be doing this range update is we would say that, okay, I have this IDX. So now this is a point update. So I can just loop from a point A to point B and update all of them, and that should work. And yeah, it does work, but the time complexity is very high. Now, why is that the case? Because if you notice that if I keep the L to R as 1 to N and then keep passing the update, so it will accumulate per query. So you will, so the usual situation is that you have N less than equal to 1E5 queries and nodes, in the array, let's say this is the usual length of the array, and then this is the number of queries. So in most cases, this will exceed the time complexity. This is not acceptable. You cannot do this. O of q into n is not possible. So we need to do something smarter, something faster. So the idea here is let's say I update this range. Let's say I want to update this whole range. And here the update operation is add. So I want to add some value to this whole range. But you should notice that even if I, let's say, add some value here, but I only query on the left subtree. So I am only querying on the this side. I am not querying here. So was it actually useful to update this? So would it be actually useful to traverse this down inside, like go here and then here and then here and here, and update everything when I'm not going to query on it? Or even if I'm going to query on it, I'll query it much later, like maybe after 200-300 queries, like that will come later. Point here being that even if you update a range, like let's say you update a range of so many elements, you don't actually always need to do it all immediately. So what you don't need to be is you don't need to be eager. This is the crucial part. Here we don't be eager. Here we be lazy. Here we say that until you ask me, like until you query this part, I won't evaluate it. That's a simple deal. If you ask me to update this red range, then what I'll do is I'll just say that I'll store some temporary value here. And that temporary value will indicate to me that there is some pending update here. I have not yet applied it, but there is something pending. So when you go in this range, be careful. But that's all I will do. I will not push it down further. So this red thing will not go down here. This red thing will not go down here until I really want it to. So that's the difference between eager and lazy evaluation. So far we have been doing eager, but now we are doing lazy. So now we want to do lazy, and I have given you the idea. The idea being that you want to store, you want to perform as little operations as possible. You want to stop as soon as you hit a node which captures the complete range. So in this case, I wanted to update the range 3 to 5. So I just stopped at the node here and I did not go down further, because I knew if I go down further, there is no point. I want to be lazy. I want to go down as little as possible. So I'll just store the pending update here and just say that, yeah, something is pending. Let it be. When we'll query, we'll see. So that's the intuition for what we're going to do. Again, don't hurry up with the implementation. I'm trying to take this slowly. So this is the pending update part. So this is pending. And now let us try to understand what the time complexity of this will be. So this is I'll just not do it properly, not formally, just on a general scale. You would see that if I update the whole tree from 1 to 5, then I'll just hit the first node and exit. But if I update larger ranges, then again I'll go to smaller nodes. But you have to notice that at every step, this and this, the range splits into half. So I will actually not touch a lot of nodes. This is the key idea here. When doing lazy, like storing these pending updates, I will not be actually touching a lot of nodes, because the range keeps splitting into half. So it is not possible to touch a lot of nodes, because each node accounts for a decent size range. And if you take too many nodes, then since your range can only be less than n, therefore, you're not going to have a lot of nodes. So overall, your complexity is still going to be log n, approximately. There might be some more, there will be a lot of constant factor, not a lot, but slightly more. But overall, it will be this, log n. So with this in mind, let us try to quote some basic idea. And again, I'm just going to change this sectree itself, so you would see how easy it is. So I'll just write a new vector, and for now I'll just keep it as this, and I'll also give it 4 into n space. So the reason why 4 into n space, because each tree node can have a corresponding pending update. Not the leaf nodes, of course. So the only nodes that will not have any pending updates are the leaf nodes, because the leaf node won't really have any pending update to its children because it has no children. So they could be excluded, but let's just keep it 4n for now, because then it's easy to debug and stuff. Both have the same size and everything. So yeah, we have just made one baby step towards defining our lazy segment tree. And now let us first change the definition of our function. So now the update function is int l to int r. Again, so I have not stopped yet for any doubts. But if you have any doubts, you can just unmute and ask. I'm looking at the chat from my phone, but I don't see any doubts, so it's fine now. If you have any questions, you can stop me. So yeah, so now this is quite straightforward. We say that if r is less than tl or l is greater than tr, then we return. Again, this is the standard thing, that when you're out of range, you don't traverse further, you just return from the update. Now we want to do some lazy stuff, some pending stuff. So the condition for pending was that when I have a range, so when my update range, let's call my update range as UL to UR, and let's call my tree range as TL to TR. So what you see on the left is that this UL to UR is actually bigger than the tree range. So the tree node is a part of the whole update. So this is a part of this, a subset, a contiguous subset in some sense. So at this point, I can stop processing the queries further. What I mean to say is that if L is less than equal to TL and TR is less than equal to R, so my tree range TL to TR is a complete subset of L to R, which is the update range, then I will do something. So not this, but I'll do something that will help me do lazy. And again, I'll return. This is the crucial part. I'll return. I will not go any further. So this can stop at the top of the tree. This can stop in the middle of the tree. This can stop anywhere, but I won't go any further. So again, I'm just leaving this out to first get the general idea right, and then we'll fill in the blanks. So this is there. This is there, and then we want to do something here as well. So this will this change? This is another interesting point to wonder upon, that will this change? So let us comment it, and we'll come back to it if it's actually going to change or not. And now I'm not going to query rate, because we want to fix the update first. So as you can see, the code is already very small. It's not big by any sense, and we'll also try to generalize it very soon. So now I want to fill something in here that will do two things. First, it will propagate, it will help propagate my updates later, and secondly, update my current tree node value. So these are the two things that it's going to fix. So you have to notice that when I am at this point and I say that, okay, this update is pending, then even though this update is pending only for my child nodes, my value itself will be latest. What I mean to say is that tree of TI will always be up to date, whereas lazy of TI, whereas let's say tree of child, this might be out of date. So this is possible. So when I store a pending update, I will ensure that my value is correct. Even though I am not pushing the values down further, I will make sure that my value is always correct. So here you will notice that if I am processing an add operation, and let's say I'm adding plus 3, I'll just write it in red. So I'm adding plus 3 to this whole range. So this range has 3 leaf nodes, 1, 2, 3. And if I'm doing plus 3 on all of them, so plus 3, plus 3, plus 3, plus 9. So this node's value will be actually plus 9, even though I was doing plus 3, because this node encompasses three different tree nodes and each of them gets a plus 3. So in total, you will have a plus 9. What that means is that tree of ti plus equal to add into tr minus tl plus 1. So here I can also write like this, just to make the point clear. So here we have corrected the value of tree ti. So again, we want to make sure that our values are correct, even though the other values, the children values, might be wrong. And then I want to say that, okay, now lazy ti add. This is the other thing that I want to say. What this is saying is that now I am storing, so lazy is kind of the, you can say, the pending store, where I am storing the values that are pending for my children. So here I am just writing that I am the tree node ti, and for my children, this particular value is still pending. So if you happen to visit them, just make sure that you take this lazy with you. This is the idea with the lazy variable. So this is all there is. So again, very simple stuff. So this is all there is. This part is done. Now we move to this part. So this part is actually correct. That's all that we needed to do, because if you look at it carefully, this ti actually got propagated to its children. So here I am doing the propagation. So I am calling the update on my left child, which you can see here, and on my right child, which is here. So when I am propagating my updates to my right, left and right children, I know that their values are always up to date. Because whenever I am propagating, of course, this is the same as the normal sec tree, the previous sec tree that we just wrote 10 minutes ago. This is the same. Whenever you call update recursively, you are propagating that information. So if I know that I have propagated the information to my children, I am guaranteed that they have ensured that their value is correct. So if this node 3 happens to propagate its value to 6 and 7, then this 3 will know that, okay, 6 would have handled its own value, because this whole setup is recursive. 6 would have handled its update and 7 would have handled its update somehow, but their own values would be correct. So because I wanted to take the sum, I'll just take the sum, and I know that their values, so tree of LCTI and tree of RCTI, will be correct. They won't be wrong. By correct, I mean up to date, and by wrong, I mean out of date in some sense, because everything is lazy. And another thing I want to do is I want to set my lazy to 0. I want to say that now I have propagated successfully to my children, and now I want to destroy my lazy if it was ever before. So I propagate to my children and I update my value, and then I destroy my lazy because I don't need it anymore. I only need the lazy when updates are pending. If there's no update pending, it's 0. So this is not all there is actually in the update. There is one more crucial thing that's missing, but I'll let one of you figure out if you want to, like, some of you might have coded it before, so you would know there is one more thing that's missing here. So that's basically the push operation. So you want to push your lazy values before going down. What I mean to say is that if I am standing at this node and then I want to go to 7, but before going to 7, I want to say that, okay, whatever my pending thing was, just push it downwards. So if plus 3 was pending on me, like you can say it was a loan or something, then since plus 3 was pending on me, so I just push it to 7 and push it to 6 before actually going to them. So in this line 51 and line 52, I am actually going to them by recursively calling them. So before going to them, I want to make sure that I am depth free. Whatever pending things I had, I'm just pushing them to the children. So I'll just define a new function push, and we'll give it all the three values. just for that, and I'll just pass it here. So what we want to do is we want to say that if lazy, so again, every time in these cases, the first thing you should have is exit condition. So when to not push? There are only two reasons to not push. One reason is that your lazy TI is zero, which means that you have nothing to push. You have nothing to push, so lazy TI is zero. Or you are the leaf node. So if you are the leaf node, you have no children. Even in that case, you would not push. So once you are done with this, then you can just write that again. So this is a tricky part. The end result of this we know will be that lazy of TI is zero. So this won't be here. This will be here. So the end result of this would be that lazy of TI is zero. But before that, we want to make sure that lazy of TI is actually passed to the children. So we'll just calculate mid. And again, I'm coding it in a way that you will realize that it's kind of repetitive. But once I get to the, once I generalize it, you will feel the power. So what I want to say is I want to say that lazy of LL plus is equal to lazy of TI. This is quite straightforward, right? What I mean to say here is that if a particular plus 3 was pending for me, now it will be pending for my children's. So now it will be pending for this guy and it will be pending for this guy. So in some sense, they will borrow my debt. So similarly this. So LL and RR are the left and right children. And I'm saying that, okay, now you take my debt. So now my debt will be zero. But before I set my debt to zero, I'll pass it on to you guys. Cool. So, but we also want to update the tree LL and we also want to update the tree RR. So this will be quite straightforward again. Plus is equal to. So this is the similar to what we did here. We take a range. And in this case, that is mid minus TL plus 1. And we multiplied by whatever was pending. Similarly, this. And in this case, this is. So, yeah. As you can see, this is exactly what we were doing in this line. So, in this line, what we said was that, okay, add is whatever is pending. And then I'll add it with range. Similarly, here I'm saying lazy is whatever is pending, and I will add it in this range. So here the range is mid minus TL plus 1, and in this it's TR minus mid. So this actually goes from TL to mid, and this actually goes from mid plus 1 to TR. All right. So with this out of the, again, this code is repetitive, but we'll fix it. You will immediately start seeing some general patterns in this, which I want you to build the intuition for. I don't want to rush it. So again, that is why we are going step by step, statement by statement. Now that this is done, do I actually need to change anything in query? This is the funniest part. So it turns out that I don't need to change anything in query. This is good. This is enough. I don't need to do anything more to change query. So I only need to change the update. I don't need to change the query because everything is already pushed, which is not. So yeah, this was the one catch there was, that whenever I'm querying, I also need to keep pushing. Because again, the motto is simple, that if I am not push here. The motto is simple, that if I stop at my own tree node, then it's fine. But if I am going to visit my children, I have to pay off my own debt. So here you can say I am paying off my own debt. Okay. So I am basically saying that whatever debt I had, I am just pushing it to the children before actually visiting them. This is the whole intuition about the lazy segment tree. And I don't need to push above, because here I am just visiting the tree node itself, but here I am visiting my children. So that is why I am doing this here. So now the file is compiling, we just revisit the problem statement. The problem statement says it's range update for add and query minimum. So, okay, so the query is not minimum right just yet. So we'll just change it to minimum. So this, so again, you have to be careful about the default values. And here we can just say minimum of A1, A2. And we'll also need to change this to minimum of this. Oh, okay. So I think I was solving a different, slightly different problem previously. So here it says query the minimum value, but I was actually solving for the sum of the range, but it is easy to change. So I'll just roll it back and let this be. So anyway, so yeah, I did not write minimum anyway. So this wasn't for the minimum part, but this was for the case when you have a range addition and range query for the sum. So I hope this part makes sense because we went step by step and we are trying to keep everything simple, and so that is there. Yeah, now we will try to generalize this. We want to write a set of functions that once we have written, we don't want to write again, because it's easy to get this whole thing wrong. Again, because I was going in a flow right now, so if you revisit this again or try to code this again, you'll find it intuitive. The basic idea, the only thing that's actually changing here is the push function. Basically, whenever you are touching your children, you are paying off your own debts before touching them, and the update part also changes. Now we want to generalize this. So I will introduce a couple of new functions that make that a lot more easier. I will say that, okay, so let us try to first observe what patterns are lying here. So one pattern that I see is this range thing. This range thing comes up where I have this range addition and I have this add into range. This is also here. This is also here. So this is in a couple of places. And I need to fix this. Okay, so this might overflow. We should put this here. So we have to fix this problem where we have a lot of repetition. So I count three occurrences here, and there could be more depending on how complicated the operation is. So the one thing that's common here is that you have a lazy value, and you have a tree node to which that lazy value is going sent in some sense. You are saying that I have this tree node and I have this lazy which needs to be applied to that tree node, and that's all. So what I want to do is I want to write a function that literally does that, apply lazy to tree node. I'm just writing it out in full, but once you have it written for once, you can just reuse it, write a smaller name, whatever. So on the left hand side, I have some tree data, and on the right hand side, I have some lazy data. And what I want to do is I want to apply this lazy data on this tree node, right? That's what you want to do. So in this case, the answer is pretty obvious. We want to do this. Again, I'll just keep it. This is fine. So yeah. So you can also put a const here, but it's okay. So what I can write now is very simple. I can write it like this. So tree ll lazy ti and tl to mid. And similarly, I can write fl this and then ti mid plus 1 ti. So what I'm doing here is I'm saying that this is my lazy value and I want to apply it to this tree node. And that's all I want to do. So now this is uniformly the same in both the tree nodes. And this will mostly always be the case. You will have the same operation on both the left and right child. If that's not the case, then it is slightly trickier problem that we'll deal with later. So then I have the same thing here. So again, what I want to do is I want to say apply lazy to tree node. My tree node is tree of ti, my lazy is add, and my range is tl to tr, and I can remove this. I'll not remove it, I'll comment it so that you can also see that this is a lot more cleaner than the previous counterpart. And this had to be lazy data. Yeah. Alright, so now we have generalized one part. So the advantage of this is that now I have to just change this here and it will adjust accordingly. And this has huge implications. So if in case my propagation functions become complicated, so when I have plus 3 here, I'm not just passing plus 3 down, I'm passing a more complicated debt. So you can imagine this function as a debt paying mechanism. So where you are like passing your debt to your children. So in most cases, this RHS is generally coming from the top and this LHS is receiving it from the bottom. So yeah, this is the way to look at this, is that your RHS is coming from the top and LHS will receive at the bottom and it wants to update accordingly itself. And the point of updating here is that the same as we discussed before, that this LHS wants to be up to date. So then we see another pattern. We see
the LHS and RHS part again.
Yeah. So LHS and RHS, basically what is, so I'll give you this example. So here you can see tree LL and lazy TI. All right. So let us say that my TI is equal to, in this case, 3 and my LL is 6, right? So I'm just borrowing from this node. So this is my TI and this is my LL, which is my left child. So what I'm saying now is that I had a pending of plus 3 and I want to pass that pending to the tree node, which is my left child. So I have a tree node, which is my left child, and it should be able to receive the pending value that I'm giving it. So the LHS happens to be that receiving tree node and the RHS happens to be that value that I'm passing it from the top. So I hope that makes some sense.
Yes, thank you.
Great. So so now we have generalized it. So now later I'll show you a more typical example where you can use this exact same structure and solve a slightly more complicated problem, slightly more. So now we have this another pattern that looks like it could be exploited. So here you have lazy LL plus is equal to lazy TI. You have lazy RR plus is equal to lazy TI. And then you also have lazy TI plus is equal to add. Again, three things look similar and could possibly be merged. So that is exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to say that I have a function that takes two values and merges them. Now again, it is important to know what those two values are. So LHS is the pre-existing pending value and the RHS is the fresh pending value that is coming from the top, right? So it is possible, for example, that this node already had a pending value of plus 10. It already somehow by some previous operation, it already had a plus 10 which was pending on it, and now its parent passes it a plus 3. So plus 3 plus 10 should be plus 13, which is exactly what we were doing previously. But now we want to do it efficiently, so we'll just write a new function for it. And we'll say that return LHS plus RHS. So it looks like it's not doing much here, but it will be very handy later. That's all I can say. So just keep this in mind that LHS is the pre-existing pending value. So in this case, it's say for example plus 10 and then some more pending is coming. So it will add the both up. So you can just write merger lazy. Again, you can also write this as void like before, and you can write LHS plus is equal to RHS. And I generally like to keep things const whenever possible. So yeah, so then I can write it as this, and similarly I can write it as this. I'll just comment this so you can appreciate the difference. It looks like there is no difference, which is correct. Of course there is little to no difference, but when we solve more complicated problems, it will be very useful. So I'll just remove this now. So again, keep the order in mind. We want to keep some things in the LHS and some things in the RHS. The things in the RHS are those which are coming from the top. So in this case, I'm saying that since I'm pushing the node T of I, so T of I is at the top, and its children are at the bottom. So that's why tree of LL, tree of RR, lazy of LL, lazy of RR is on the LHS. It's at the bottom. It's receiving stuff, and the other things are on the right side. They're sending stuff. So that's there. Then I want to also apply it here. So merger lazy, lazy TI add. And yeah, I'll just comment this. So you can see it's doing the same thing, but in a much cleaner way. So I'll remove it. So now our code is already started to look a lot cleaner. And you can see the big breakthrough that we're achieving slowly and steadily is that we're understanding the lazy sectree black box. So we're actually like poking at each statement and understanding that, okay, this part and these two parts are actually the same. But this is a pretty strong statement to make. Like initially when I had written a plus here and I had written a plus here, if you looked at them from a distance, you could say they are same, but it could also be possible they were different because there were a lot of pluses and minuses going on. But now that I've written them in a single function, merger lazy, here and here and similarly here, I have made it very clear that this is exactly the same thing that is going on in this place and in the place here as well. It's exactly the same thing. So this, we are slowly understanding the lazy sectree black box as in how it's actually operating. So these are the two main components of how it manages to push the value, push the pending value down. So to push the pending value down, just to recap, it says that I will take my own lazy. Again, if my lazy is zero, I won't push. That makes no sense. But if I do have lazy, I will take my left child and pass my lazy to it. I will take my right child and pass my lazy to it. And then I will update their lazy values as well. And then I'll set my own lazy to zero. So this functions make it very explicit as to what is going on. That's a good question. Is there a specific reason for apply lazy? Exactly. There is a very important reason in that they are actually doing two different tasks. So lazy LL, so merger lazy is merging two different lazy nodes. Whereas apply lazy to tree node is in some sense applying this lazy value RHS. I'll just show you the function. So applied lazy to tree node is applying this RHS on a tree. Whereas here we are applying the RHS on a lazy value. So as you can see, their statements are also different. When you are taking a pending value and pushing it down to a tree, it's not the same as taking the lazy value and pushing it to another lazy node, as you can see here. So I'll just illustrate that with an example once again. So here I'll just draw it once again so that it makes it becomes cleaner. So I'll just copy the previous nodes. So you have 3, 6, you have 7, and now this node had a pending of plus 3. So when this node has a pending of plus 3, you notice that even though it is pending plus 3, when it will, what were the ranges? Yeah, 3 to 4 and 5. When it actually pushes this plus 3 to the left child, then the value of the left child will be 3, like plus 3 and plus 3. It will be plus 6. It will be added because this 6 actually has two nodes inside it. Like its range has two nodes. Like this range was 3 to 5, so we had split into two parts, 3 to 4 and 5. So this range actually has two parts for the node 6, and that is why when you push this pending down, this is the pending value. When you push it down, in the case of 6, it will not be a simple addition of plus 3. It will be an addition of plus 3, the number of times that there are nodes. So in this case, there are two nodes. So plus 3, plus 3, plus 6. And in so similarly, value of right child will only be plus 3. This is not equal to, this is addition. So we try to get this clear. So this is why this is apply lazy. I'm saying that I'm taking a pending slash lazy value and I'm applying it on the actual tree values. But now those tree values themselves have some lazy values also. In those cases, so now I can say that lazy of left child, that won't change. That will still be only plus 3. And similarly for the right child, that will also be only plus 3. Because we want to make sure, because lazy, the way we have defined it, we only multiply it when we actually hit a tree. As long as we are not hitting a tree, we just keep passing it like that. So that's why these are separate. In a lot of cases, they might be similar, but in most cases, you'll find them to be different actually. So yeah, that is there. So again, on the surface, you can look at this and say that when you push a value, you want to push your debt. So when you're pushing your debt or your loan or your lazy or pending or whatever, you will first apply that pending value to your child tree nodes. And then you will also merge your loan with their loans. So this is the merger part. And then you want to set this to zero. So this is the three-step process that we do. Cool. So that is there. And yeah, that is actually pretty effective and that will help us solve the next problem. But we want to define one more function. So there is just one last function and that is, I'll just let you think about it for a minute. So we have done two things. We have, I'll not use this diagram, I'll use this. So we've done two new functions, actually three new functions, but apart from push, we have done apply lazy, which takes the lazy from here and pushes it down to the tree nodes. We have done merge lazy, which takes this lazy and merges it to the child lazy. But we have not done another kind of merger, which is that we want to also pull the value up, right? This part, if I bring your attention to this part right here, once you have updated the left child right here, and once you have updated the right child right here, you want to take their updated values and merge them into yourself, right? You want to take their updated values and merge them into yourself. So what is this called? So this is easy to guess, but I'll just write it out. So you want to write a function that will merge tree. So I'll not keep it void this time for reasons that will become clear. So what this does is that it takes a tree node which is from the left and it takes a tree node which is from the right, and then it will try to merge them. That's all. In our case, this is very simple. This is just left plus right. But again, it can be different depending on the scenario. So now what I want to do is I want to say that tree data is this merger tree and this. So convince yourself that this is the same thing as before. This is literally going to add them both together, but this is explicitly making it clear that what this step does is just merging the two left and right children. So I'll just obviously do it here as well. So I will also do a couple of changes that will become intuitive why I'm doing it. So this is the changes. So as you can see, the query function always returns some value of the form tree data, which is quite intuitive because when you are querying, you are always querying over tree values. Like here you can see I'm returning a value which is of the form tree, and then I'm merging trees. So when I'm returning trees and merging trees, overall I have data that is of the type tree data. So that's why this query function is like this. Again, I have not really changed the functionality in the past 20 minutes, but if you look at this code now, the key difference here is that every statement has a word in it. For example, here is a word, apply lazy to tree node. Here is a word, apply lazy to tree node. This is merger lazy. This is merger lazy. Now, of course, I could write this as reset something, but let's just let this be there. But the most critical operations, like here, apply lazy, merger lazy, similarly update, update, push, merger, each statement has a name. And this helps you grasp the idea of what that function is trying to do. So the key difference of this code versus the normal lazy sectory code that you generally would be writing is that this is a lot cleaner, in the sense that now if I want to use this sectory to solve a different problem, all I need to do is change these things. I need to change how this works, I need to change how this works and how this works, and also how the push changes, how I'm pushing values, but everything else remains the same. So the entire structure of everything else remains the same, and this whole code is now very modular, very structured and very clean. So yeah, this is the crucial part that we wanted to get clear, is that we wanted to have a thorough understanding of the black box and write code that is easily generalizable. So this is precisely what we have done. So again, I know this is very new. So some of this might not make exact sense, but when you'll write this code out, again, I'll just upload everything after the meet. But when you'll just write out everything on your own, by getting the intuition. So the intuition here is that if you look at the different words in the two functions, so update and query, remember, there were only two functions to begin with. There was only update and there was query. There were only two functions that we ever had in the beginning, and we have expanded them by adding some new functions. But if you notice, the core of these functions, update and query, is quite the same. So what does update do? Let us just quickly walk through it one last time. What it does, it says, if my update is out of bounds, then return. Obviously, this is the exit condition. If my tree range is a subset of the update range, right? Then what I want to do, I don't want to go any further. So that's a return right there. But before returning, I want to make sure that whatever lazy data you were giving me, so lazy data add you were giving me, I want to apply it on myself. So as I mentioned earlier, I want to make sure my value is correct. So that's why I'm saying apply lazy to tree node. But I also want to push it down to my children. So I want to make sure that my children know there is something pending. So I want to just keep this in my pending. So lazy of ti add merger lazy, and I'll return. Otherwise, I want to push my stuff downwards. And once I've pushed, I can only then traverse to my children. So this is the important part. I have to first push my loan to my children. And then once they have updated themselves somehow that I don't really care about, once they are done updating, I will just re-update my value. I will just take their left child, take their right child, and then merge it. And that's all. In some sense, this is very similar to the previous update, but now this is a whole more clearer. Similarly, in query, I say that if my ranges are out, I return 0. And if my tree node is completely contained, I return tree of ti. Otherwise, again, I have to push. This is the critical step. I have to push because I am in the very next statement going to visit my children. So if I am to visit my children, I have to push. So I visit my children, they give me some answer. I store it as answer A1, answer A2, and then I merge that together as well. So I'm using merger tree here because I know that query always returns a data of type tree of ti. So that's why I'm able to do this. Again, this is just some convention that I use. This overall makes the code a whole lot cleaner and precise. So it makes it difficult for you to make mistakes, because now you have made it clear what query should return, what different things should return. So yeah, this is a very thorough understanding of the black box that we have. And again, I would encourage you after the meet to code this on your own completely. And if you are stuck, you can look at the recording and see what part you might want to look at. But now that we are done with this part, I want to look at another problem, and it is this problem. So again, so we are done with this live coding, and now we want to this. So this will require slight modifications, but you will realize that this modification is not a lot, which is what we promised. So now we will put it to test. So I'll give you a few seconds, minutes to think about it. And so I have pasted the link to this GitHub thing on the chat, and I'll just leave this code open so you can look at this. So I'll give you a hint that this is the only part that you actually need to change. Yeah, this is the only part that you need to change. So think about it, what you should be changing in this so that you can get the desired effect. Of course, you will also need to change tree data and lazy data because, well, yeah. Now you have a whole more lot complicated queries, so that will also be changed. So I guess I'll just tell the answer now. Okay, so the one change that we definitely need to do is use a struct, because now we can no longer work with one int or two ints and stuff like that. We need to use structs to store the data that we are actually passing around. So here you can see that we have two different types of updates. We have an addition update and a set update. So okay, this was addition. Okay, fine. So we have an addition and a set update. So I'll just write it out. So my tree data is only always. Actually, I can set my tree. So I can let my tree data be a long, but I need this. So I will use setVal. I will use addVal. And yeah, so I have two different values now, and we'll see how to deal with this. So let's go step by step. We'll see if we need to change this or not, and that's how we learn, trial and error. So let's see. So lazy data. So we look at this function and we ask it, what does it want us to do with it? So this function tells us that it wants you to take this lazy data and apply it on this tree node. This is what it wants you to do. So so let's see. So the first thing that we want to do is we want to check if RHS. So the one crucial part that you want to check is int is set. I'll keep it bool. And is and. So I want to. So the problem here is that it is also possible that in some queries, only this part is set. There is only setting, there is no addition. Similarly, in some cases, there might be addition only and no setting. So I want to be able to handle both parts. So what I want to say is that if RHS.isSet, so if it is it wants to set some value, in that case, how will my value change? My value will change in the way that first I'll define a range. So since my value is the sum of my children, so it will become this, right? So quite straightforward. What I'm saying is that if whatever is coming from the top, so RHS, does it want me to set a value? If it does, then I literally set the value. So here you have seen assignment operation. So I want to set it to range into RHS.setVal, because that is what my sum is going to be. Similarly, I'll say that if RHS.isAdd, then almost the same thing, I want to say LHS plus is equal to range into RHS.addVal. So yeah, so it's literally describing what it's trying to do. It says that if I want to set, then I'll set. If I want to add, I'll add. And that's all. So now let's go here. So again, this I hope is clear, because this is like it's basically saying what it wants to do. So now we go to this part. So what this part wants us to do is it wants to us to take the LHS lazy and the RHS lazy and merge them. So here the key thing to note here is that RHS is fresh, where LHS is old. So it is possible that, for example, LHS had, so let's say that LHS had a addition operation. So it might happen that LHS had an addition operation. So it was the pre-existing pending value, but RHS has a set operation. So the now the thing here is that since RHS is coming fresh, while LHS was the previous pending, so even if LHS was the addition, we will have to discard it. So if there was something that LHS was adding, then it won't be able to add it anymore. So if LHS is add and RHS is set, then I want to say that azadd is zero, right? So we'll not be adding anything from there. In fact, you can also say that and RHS dot is set, then LHS dot is set is also zero. I should be writing false here, but okay. So you can see here that every time RHS has something to set, LHS just dies. LHS cannot do anything. It cannot set a value, it cannot add a value, because RHS is the fresh lazy thing that is incoming from the top. So if RHS is setting something, then it will overwrite whatever the previous thing was trying to do. So I can basically write that if RHS dot is set, then LHS dot is set is equal to LHS dot is add is false. So I can just write this in one line. That's it. So yeah, that's all. Now what I can do is I can just manually check each part. So if LHS dot is set, so again, so what I want to do now is if RHS dot is set, then so what will happen as a result of this is that LHS will be overwritten, right? So that's why I'm overwriting the LHS. So LHS dot is set is equal to RHS dot is set, right? Straightforward. And then if RHS dot is add, then it will get added. So LHS dot is add plus is equal to RHS dot is add. So you can look at it for a while that it actually does everything. So a good check to always have in this case is to look at the two cross two values. So there will be a lot of different paths. So sometimes the LHS is set can be true, sometimes can be false, sometimes so different booleans can be true and false. So you can just hand pick and check them that they work, but right now you can just assume that this is correct. So you can intuitively reason that if RHS dot is set, then LHS is going to die. LHS won't be able to do anything. And if RHS is set, then wait, okay, there was something. Right, so if RHS is set, then LHS will have to be set, and LHS set val will be the same as the RHS set val. Similarly, if RHS is adding something, then LHS will also be adding, and you can also do this crucial check that if it was not adding before. So again, I'm just doing this by trial and error and noticing what are the different edge cases that can go wrong and right. So once you become practice this for a while, you'll understand this idea better as to how I'm looking at this. So yeah, now this merging is done. Now I finally need to merge the tree. So merging tree, if you notice carefully, this is only relevant when you are querying. So this will still remain the sum. Why? Because the query, okay, I have written minimum here, but let's just keep it sum for now because it's easier to deal with that. So this will remain, I'll just change it to sum later. So yeah, this will remain sum. You can convince yourself that that is the case because we are working with tree data. So yeah, so that is there. Now, so now we are pushing, and now this will also get interesting slightly, slightly, not a lot. So the only change that will take place is if LHS, so the only time I don't want to push is when I'm not adding anything and I'm not setting anything. Yeah. So the only time I'm not going to push further is when I'm not adding, I'm not setting, so then I'll return. And it turns out that this part can remain the same as it is, because it does not actually matter. This part will remain the same. So you can look at the code and convince yourself that. So in most cases, this will not change. Okay. So here I have to set the default value. So you can set it to something like 0000. As long as you keep your booleans false, it will work fine. So yeah, so that is there. This part will not change. In most cases, this part never changes. This part only changes when the value here is different. So when, for example, here you're passing lazy TI and here you're passing something else. In that case, it will change. And this is one of the questions at the bottom. So when you have weighted queries or segment min-max or adding an AP to an update range, then this is a problem, but in usual cases it's not a problem. So right here it's not a problem. So I just wrote merger tree, I just wrote merger lazy, and I just wrote apply lazy to tree node, and I am able to answer this complicated looking question. So this shows us how we have generalized our segment tree to be able to answer different queries easily. So yeah, as you can see, that is there. Again, you should really convince yourself that this is the case, or you can take my word for it that you'd only need to change push when you have to change these lazy TIs. Otherwise, it's all fine. It's always fine. So yeah. So I'll just write out the relevant part. So this is mostly relevant in update ending. Or when querying. Again, this is mostly relevant to querying, because the only time you're using this is when querying and when updating at the end. So that, and then this is mostly relevant to merging lazy, and then this is relevant to that. So yeah, that's there. I also wanted to look at some of the questions, but turns out this took a slightly more time than usual. Anyway, we'll just look at one of the questions so that we want to like solve some real world problems. So let's look at this problem. So I'll give you a couple of 1 or 2 minutes to read it. It's actually a very simple statement, but exceedingly complicated thought process if you don't know lazy sectories. But now that you know, you can try to solve it. All right, so basically I'll just reveal the solution directly because there are not many ways to think about this problem. You could try using, for example, Moore's algorithm or something, but since the queries are online, it's not really going to work because the queries are not online in the strictest sense, but you really want to process each query as it comes, so that's why it is in some sense online. Anyway, so let us quickly sketch the solution, and the solution is let us try to understand what happens when I sort. Let's use a different thing. When I sort a range from A1 to A10. So let us just look at the problem itself. So let's say I have this. So now what would happen if I happen to sort the first four characters, then this would transform to AABC, and then this part will remain the same, right? So the only change that happened is in this. So this is the effect that happens when you sort 1 to 4, right? Now we want to understand this process in a bit more sensible way. Like, this is quite typical, and let us try to reword it in a different way. Let us reword it in a way, instead of sorting. What is sorting? Sorting is when you're sorting lowercase alphabets, there are only 26 of them. You can say that sorting is basically the same as first count. I'll just write it with this. So first count how many times each letter appears. So count how many times A appears, count how many times B appears, C appears, and then put them back in the same place in the correct order. So does this make sense? So what is sorting in this case? In some sense, you can look at this as counting sort. You count, if I'm to sort this range L to R, then how many times does letter A appear in this range, letter B appear in this range, and then I want to put these letters back in the same place but in the correct order. So in this case, I look at this range and say that okay, A two times, B once, C once, and the rest are all zero. And I then want to take this and put it in the correct order. So the correct order is AABC in the sorted order. And now our problem is drastically simpler. So you will recognize that this has two parts. And the first part is a range query. And the second part is a range update. So what I mean by that is when you want to count how many times the letter small a appears in a range L to R. Again, I'm not going into the implementation right away. Let us take the meaning of the words for now. If I'm counting the letters in a range L to R, then that is a range query, of course. That's literally a range query. And similarly, if I'm putting them back in the same place in the correct order, then that's a range update. So in this case, I am updating that, okay, range 1 to 2 is A, range 3 to 3 is B, range 4 to 4 is C. Of course, these ranges are small, but when they are large, lazy update would help us. So the first part is range query, the second part is range update, and we know how to do this. This is literally the same as what we did before. If you look at this, this is a range update and this is a range query. This is a range update, range query. Range update, range query. So this is a lazy sec tree, and this is what we have been doing. So this question is looking difficult, like it's a diff to E. So you might be thinking that this is very difficult, but once you know lazy sec tree and you understand this trick, what does it mean to do sort? Sorting basically is counting the letters and then putting them back in the right place. And one is a range query, one is a range update. And now you can use a lazy sec tree to perform this and output the final answer. So I'm not going to code this because we are out of time, and also it's quite intuitive now what to do next. There is one key trick to keep in mind, that you will want to maintain 26 segment trees. The straightforward reason being is that each sec tree will count the will do range query and range update for one letter. So the first sec tree will tackle only the letter A, the second sec tree will tackle the letter B, and so on. So so you can do something like sec tree, and then you can write trees, and then you can 26. So this will initialize 26 different sec trees, and then you can work with them individually. So if for example, in this case, so the A segment tree would interpret it as 1010, the B segment tree would interpret it as 0100, and C1 would interpret it as 001. So yeah, every time the B occurs, it's 1, every time it does not occur, it's a 0. So, and then it's a straightforward range query, range update, lazy segment tree, which we literally did. So that's a hard contest problem. That, so it's rated 2300, And but it's actually quite easy to get once you know this concept. So now I have also wanted to discuss some other things, but we are out of time, so I'll try to end here. Again, you can look at the location. So I'll recommend you start from the Edu portal, and it has a lot of practice questions that you can use to submit. So all the questions that we discussed today, not all of them are there. So like this, some of them were not there, I think. But in any case, this is the part two for the Code Forces Edu, and you can go to the practice section and just submit this code straight away. It should work. So addition to segment for some, most of them is pretty straightforward. I'll just link to my submission, my code, this code, so that you can use it as a template and make changes or whatever, and you can reference it when required. And you can also look at this page, which is a blog, which has a lot of good segmentary problems, and you can look at it this section. So I have done most of these problems. I have done this. I have done a lot of them. So you can find my code in the standings and look at it. So mostly it follows a similar structure. So if I go here, and wait, I could have seen it before. So if I look at this, so again, it follows the same structure: merge tree, merge lazy. I'm calling this assign tree, but this is basically the apply lazy on tree thing. So that is there. Then there is push, then there is update, then there is query, then there is solve, then there is new. So everything is the same way. So you can look at it and understand. And so yeah, that's all for, again, this will, so once you start coding, you'll realize that this is slightly tougher than what I was making it look like, but yeah, once you code it on your own, you'll get the whole intuition around it. So anyway, so yeah, if there's any questions, I can stay back or we can end the meet now. So when you guys like code this up later and try to submit, and if you get stuck somewhere, then you can also ping me and message me which part is going wrong. So like I can help you debug in the initial stages. But then the condition is that you have to use this template that I am using. This is a very clean template, and this makes debugging a whole lot easier. So yeah. And in general, the only way to debug segment trees is really by looking at the individual values. So in this case, if I was to debug this segment tree, for example, then I would go here and I would use GDB, for which we can take a session later. But we would use GDB and inspect the individual values. So if I look at this tree structure, so here I have this tree. So I will look at each of these nodes and try to make sure that their values are exactly what I was thinking that they should be, and make sure that they are the same. There is no easy way to debug segment trees in what I'm trying to say. That's why it's very important to get the basic structure right, which is what I was trying to do here, which is make sure that with all these different functions, the basic structure is so intuitive that it becomes harder to make a mistake, which is the idea. So yeah, anyway, as I said, when you guys code, you can send me your submissions. I can help you debug them if you get stuck, and yeah, great. So since there were no doubts, I'll just stop the recording now and end the meet. Okay then.